Hello everybody, welcome at Food Film Talks. My name is Vroukje Jansen, which is a very difficult name to pronounce in English, I know. So people, when I travel, people call me Vroukje. So today I'm Vroukje Jansen. Yes, Vroukje. And we serve you, I hope, a very interesting and inspiring talk show. We have very, very lovely and great guests. And we serve it as a meal. So we have small bites, we have main courses, we have desserts. And you will find out what you are. If you're like a small bite, if you're a main course or whatsoever. We do the talk show in English. And we love to be it very informal. So if you have like a question for one of the speakers, please raise your hand and I will come to you. I have like this high heels, but I will do it. Yeah? Okay. Who of you has already eaten at a restaurant just across the street? Please raise your... Was it good? Yes. Very good, huh? It's a very, very good menu. And did you also see the little films shown there? Yeah! Yeah, well, a lot of people haven't seen the short film shown over there, and it's about the food. So there, it's small little films about how the food is made. And I'd like to show you a small scene. I'd like to show you a small scene. A short scene, maybe. Yes.
Je hebt, als je naar kippen kijkt, heb je eigenlijk twee verschillende ketens. Eentje is de vleesketen en de andere is de legketen. De vleesketen, dat zijn hennetjes en haantjes door elkaar. Die worden dus ook allemaal in een stal gezet en die laat je ongeveer 6 weken groeien. En vervolgens gaan ze als vlees naar supermarkt en dergelijke. De andere keten is de legketen. Daar heb je ook hennetjes en haantjes. Maar de haantjes leggen geen eieren, dus die zijn in principe economisch nutteloos. Dus de hennetjes die mogen door naar de opfokbedrijven om uiteindelijk eieren te gaan leggen. En de haantjes die worden op dag 0 gedood. En in Nederland gaan die nog veelal naar als voeding weg voor dieren, dus naar dierentuin en dergelijke. Maar in een heel gedeelte van Europa ja, is het in principe echt afval. En daar zie je eigenlijk steeds meer een maatschappelijke discussie over komen of dat ethisch en maatschappelijk wel verantwoord is. Nou, en ik zit van vroeger uit al in de kippen. Mijn vader was een kippenboer en die had zo'n opfokbedrijf waar we de hennetjes grootbrachten om uiteindelijk eieren te gaan leggen. En daar zat af en toe per ongeluk een haantje tussen. En wat ik vanuit vroeger nog weet, want toen aten we ze dan maar zelf op, dat die gewoon heel erg lekker waren. En gezien de maatschappelijke discussie die ontstaat over het doden van die haantjes, plus het feit dat ik van vroeger uit wist dat dat nog heel lekker is, dacht ik van waarom ga ik niet proberen om daar zelf een kleine keten van op te zetten, zodat meer mensen van die haantjes kunnen genieten.
Het is vaster eigenlijk, het is echt dat, ja, dat oudere vlees, of ja, het ouderwetse vlees eigenlijk, laten we het zo zeggen. Het is een haan die is niet gemaakt om vlees aan te zetten eigenlijk, dus qua groei moet je, ja, is het eigenlijk allemaal wat langzamer, maar wel des te leuker eigenlijk.
Als je gewoon naar de pure vleeskuikenindustrie kijkt, daar worden de haantjes zeg maar in ongeveer 6 weken tijd ruim 2 kilo. En bij ons was dus in 12 weken tijd ongeveer 1 kilo. Dus ze leven dubbel zo lang en je hebt eigenlijk maar de helft van het gewicht. Op dit moment is het absoluut een druppel op een gloeiende plaat, want we hebben in Nederland 40 miljoen van die haankuikens en ik lever er 500 per week af, dus dat is absoluut een druppel. Maar als ik gewoon al in het begin kijk, we begonnen met 250 haantjes per week en op dit moment doen we er 500 per week. Dus het groeit wel, daar is toch duidelijk vraag naar.
Thank you so much. Please welcome on stage Florence Bovy, the filmmaker of this short film. Florence, we serve you as a small bite, so good. Please take a seat. You did a great job.
Thank you.
Yeah, and did you come up with the idea of making short films about where the food comes from?
No, that was, I was asked by the Food Film Festival, by the director, Janno Lanjau. And they had the idea because they have the chefs, and they had this idea to tell the story behind the food that's in your on your plate. And I'm also not that known with food. So for me, it was actually a really cool experience to be seeing all of this and being the city girl that I am.
And what did you learn out of it?
Well, exactly. I'm a typical city girl, so I don't know anything about where my food comes from. So in
speak
that
for yourself.
I'm sorry. And I think in that sense, it's the exact thing that YFM tries to do to make us conscious about the food that we're eating. And they kind of had me as a test case, putting me there as a filmmaker in a cage with 500 roosters and realizing what I'm eating.
And did you check the people's reactions while they were eating their food and saw how it was prepared and where it came from?
Yeah, well, it's interesting because actually there's a second part of this film, which is also not shown in the restaurant, is where we go to the slaughterhouse. And we try to even maybe show part of that in the restaurant, but obviously that's not going to work. But in general, they seem to be okay.
That's interesting, because why is it not going to work? I mean, we all know when we're eating meat, you know, that somehow it got slaughtered.
Yes, but I think there's still part of us that just doesn't want to be too conscious of the fact that something actually died. And so we're okay with thinking that it went well, but we don't want to realize it as we're eating it.
So this is like a little start.
Yeah, I think so.
Do you think will become a new trend, you know, when you go to a restaurant and you just see like short films of where it comes from?
I think it works. I think it's a nice thing that you're eating, and for instance, there's also the part about the fish, and you see the way that the fish is prepared, and I think it adds to the experience of what you're eating.
I think so too. Yeah. I know it's a Dutch expression, a hole in the market, but you found one.
Well, they found one, I have to say.
Okay, yeah, they found one. Thank you.
Thank you, Janno.
You got accepted at the Film Academy.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty sure we're going to hear a lot more from you. Thank you so much for making this short film. So if you want to see it, just go across the street. And I think you made like five...
We made three.
Three.
But the full films are like on the website, and this is kind of a compilation that's a little bit softer on the eyes.
I think you did a pretty good job. Thank you so much. Florence Bouvy. Yeah. I wanted to kiss you, but then, come here. I mean, it's like a meal. So we do kiss and we do talk. The next guest I'd like to introduce to you is Kasper Zonnen, and he's the man of DocLab and New Media at ITVA. So please come on stage with a warm applause, of course. And Kasper told me that he was not going to tell me that much about what he was going to show us. So it's kind of a surprise for us and also for him. But it's called, let me see, Eating the Internet. What do you mean by that?
I'll try to figure out what I mean by that.
Yeah, okay. If you have questions, what do you prefer? Can people like just raise their hands and I just...
They can raise their hands.
They can raise their hands and I will drop over. And otherwise, at the end of your presentation, we'll have time to discuss. Okay, enjoy.
Hello, yes. Let's see if this screen works. Yes, this screen works. My laptop just broke, as it should, right before a presentation, so I'm doing it from another device, and everything will be fine. So thank you, first of all, Janno, Joris, Food Film Festival. I've been working with you guys at ITVA, where I work, Documentary Film Festival Amsterdam. For years, you were my favorite colleagues. Now you're running a much cooler festival in certain regards. And it's an honor to be here. And I'm going to talk about Eating the Internet, which was the working title that we came up with before we actually knew what we were going to do. And I just wanted to start with this comic. It's a pretty old one. I think a lot of people have seen it. But just to get a sense of the room, how many? So it's a man checking his iPhone, a woman, probably his wife, girlfriend, asking him, "Do you mind if I strap your phone to my forehead so I can pretend you're looking at me when I talk?" Question: would you raise your hand if you can identify with that woman, if you've ever experienced something like that? So that's. And how many? Like, it's okay to raise your hand twice. If you're really honest, how many of you have done maybe a similar thing like the man is doing right there? Sorry, both for me as well. So most people did both, which I think is something we see when we go to restaurants. We see this a lot, right? We see couples having a quality moment together, talking about where they want to take their future and their lives. And I think it's an interesting thing that I'm not sure if it's a coincidence, but have you noticed that while we stopped smoking in restaurants and the ashtrays were going away from the tables, the iPhones were actually coming onto the tables? And we all sort of, or a lot of people, stopped smoking and got addicted, replaced that addiction with checking their phone. And I think that for me is a reason why we should ask if the internet, digital culture, if it's also addictive, and if we can't help doing it, even though we dislike how we're doing it, what is it that makes us do that? What are we eating? What are we consuming when we check Facebook all the time? Well, of course, the first thing that we eat is Facebook. Apparently, most women wake up and the first thing they check is Facebook. I think men are more known for taking their phones to the toilet. This is statistical research from the last few years. But okay, so we do Instagram. We watch a lot of cats when we go to the internet. We watch a lot of babies, at least if you're a young parent like me. And we watch a lot of bacon. I don't know why, but bacon is one of the biggest things on the internet after cats and babies. And of course, the internet is a great mirror of who we are and what we do. These are a few images from a website called Pictures of Hipsters Taking Pictures of Food. And I think this sort of epitomizes how we deal with the internet. We all think these guys are dicks and jerks, and actually we do the same thing in a way. But we love going to the internet and seeing people who are worse than we are. Yes. So another question I think that is good to ask is, if we're pouring so much of ourselves, of our private lives into Facebook and the rest of the internet, if we're spending so much quality time watching a screen, what is the internet doing for us? And as we're here at the Food Film Festival, what is the internet doing for food? And I just want to show you a little clip of something that's in a way sort of shows how the internet has created problems, and of course it wouldn't be the internet if it would only also propose new solutions for those problems that it created itself. And in Korea, which is before the Netherlands, the country with the most connected and fastest broadband connections in the world, there is a thing called mukbang, which is Korean webcam dining, and I'll just show you a little clip.
Park So-yeon lays a Korean feast in front of her computer, then she turns on a video camera, she eats, and thousands of viewers watch her. This is the latest fad in South Korea, gastronomic voyeurism, in a country with one of the best internet connectivities in the world. Park, known as the Diva, broadcasts herself eating in her apartment for up to 3 hours every day. Viewers can chat with her or send virtual balloons that translate into cash.
People enjoy the vicarious pleasure with my online show when they can't eat that much, or don't want to eat food at night, or are on a diet.
She earns more than $9,000 a month doing this and has quit her job at a consulting firm.
$9,000 a month. That's a pretty good income for eating in front of your webcam for... So the people who are watching, they can send virtual balloons. And I'll just show you a little clip of the mukbang performer that I like the most. I can't read Korean, so I can't tell you her name. But I'll show you a little clip of one of her dining sessions. And you can see the balloons as well, I think. This video has been watched 180,000 times so far. You need a lot of food if you're gonna eat for 3 hours, right? So this is further down the line.
어, 소화됐어. 우리 라니 발표소도 50개 또 50개. 어머. 아우. 우리 라니 발표소는 50개.
So she's watching the virtual gifts that she gets that actually get her paid.
너나 참 먹어. 대장.
So in a sense, whether this is a solution to a problem that works is not the point. The point is that Silicon Valley digital culture, digital entrepreneurs are seeing how sort of culture is changing, how the way our lives, or how we behave are changing. And they see that the food industry is not evolving quickly enough to their taste. Just like they don't think that the TV industry is changing quickly enough, so they started YouTube. And food is a big thing. In 2013, Silicon Valley venture capitalists invested $1.2 billion in food-related startups. And these can be not necessarily huge and successful things, but a lot of them are pretty silly. This one is the bacon alarm clock. It's a little dongle that you attach to your iPhone and you wake up to the smell of freshly baked bacon. I've actually tested it. It works. It's great. Then you wake up to the smell of bacon. So you get up and you make some bacon.
Yeah, okay.
It's a pretty good incentive to get up and not hit snooze. Another one, which is actually not a real product, but was a fake product used in a campaign to promote water wells, or get money for water wells, is the Wonder Winemaker. It sold for $400 and it claimed that it could turn water into wine. And people believed it, which is an interesting thing. Another one, which is not 100% sure whether it's true or not, it's an early product by Bite Labs, who took the idea of growing meat from tissue and then combining that with our obsession for people like Kanye West. So you could grow, out of some Kanye West tissue, you could grow an artisanal salami and order that. While we're talking about eating gross things, there is a guy who runs a website called Cooking with Cum. He wrote books on semenology, as he calls it, where he claims one of the great food innovations will be eating sperm. And this is a picture from the Macho Mojito. I think for me, the most shocking one is Soylent. Who here knows what Soylent is? Let's keep it like that. No, sorry, I'm just going to show a little clip. First, the tagline is, what if you never had to worry about food again? Which I think is one of the weirdest questions I've come across in a long time, because I love food. I'm never worrying about food. I don't see it as a problem. I see it as a great thing. But
Soylent began as an idea to create the ultimate food. The goal wasn't to replace food, but to provide a better alternative to what we usually eat.
It takes a little bit of perspective to see that food really is made out of chemicals. It is reducible, and we can build it back up, and we can change it, and we can make it better.
So I'm not going to show the entire commercial, but it shows you the way that Steve Jobs still inspires people to be in white rooms and be all sort of ephemeral. And as with the hipsters taking pictures of their food, the internet, again, is a great place for actually reflecting on what's happening on the internet. So Mashable.com, one of the biggest tech blogs out there, created, using the real Soylent product, they ordered it and created a little spoof commercial for it.
Are you a busy professional or a startup entrepreneur? Have we got the product for you? Introducing Soylent, the next phase in human consumption technology. Soylent! Soylent is a nutritional substitute that lets you reclaim the most wasteful part of your day, eating. Soylent is a tasteless gray powder that contains all the protein, fiber, carbs, vitamins, and minerals to fuel your unquenchable lust for success. Simply mix this patent-pending formula with water, add the mystery oil, and you're good to go. Just one bag replaces all of your daily food consumption.
I don't have time for food or human relationships. Soylent is a real time saver, and I don't even mind the scurvy.
Soylent gave me my life back. I finally have time to use Google Plus.
A lot of geeks in here. So yes, some of these are hoaxes. The artisanal celebrity salami is a hoax. The water, turning water into wine, was a campaign for actually making people aware of how precious water is. But sadly, the sperm one and the Soylent one are not hoaxes. That said, the way that we consume, share these campaigns, these websites, the way we consume these things, the way that we behave online, it all generates real data. Data that, again, Silicon Valley and the web can use. So an interesting thing is, for instance, food networks. One of the things that Wired magazine took all the data, the entire database of the Food Network, one of the biggest US-based websites for sharing recipes and rating recipes, and actually analyzing that data, they could see that, as should not come as a surprise, bacon next to gluten-free and cupcakes are the three biggest trends dominating conversations about food right now. When you see it, I actually think, yeah, that's right. I used to buy a lot of portobello mushrooms because I thought that was cool, and now I never buy them anymore. And maybe this is just for me and not for you, but salted caramel is one of the coolest things. I really love that, and the Tony Chocolonely salted caramel one, perfect. Quinoa, I don't even know what sriracha is, so it's perfect for me as well. I can now talk about sriracha, not really know.
Does anyone know what sriracha is?
Please.
Yes, okay, we're gonna find out. What is it?
It's a Vietnamese chili sauce.
How do you know that?
I eat it.
There's also a short film exactly about that product.
Okay. Perfect, so we know.
And they're the most trendy people in the audience.
Yeah, thank you.
And of course, scientific research proves that the single recipe that could increase the ratings of a recipe on amongst the thousands and thousands of recipes and ratings on this website, bacon is the thing that improves everything. So you add bacon to almost any type of dish and the ratings go up, which is a good tip if you're like owning a restaurant or selling sandwiches. I'm not going to show this clip, but this guy works at IBM. He has very interesting jewelry, but he actually is one of the people building Watson, which is an artificial intelligence supercomputer built by IBM that already can beat humans in quiz shows. And they're taking these types of data and using that to basically work together with cooks how computers can replace cooks. How can computers come up with more interesting flavor combinations than humans can that will actually be guaranteed success?
We thought of what would be a good way to...
Apologies. So apart from showing you things that I kind of frown upon or find funny or interesting, I think it's nice to also show you a few things that I'm excited about and that I really like about how digital culture is doing something for us. And one of my favorite projects ever, one of my favorite web projects ever, is called We Feel Fine by an artist called Jonathan Harris. And he made a project in which he mined all the human emotions poured into blogs, created a database, basically an almanac of human emotion. And out of that database, they also created a book in which they shared some of the more interesting findings. And I love this one, which shows you two versions of the US. One, on the left, we see the states where people feel fat the most. And on the right, we see the states where people are fat the most. And interestingly, the more thinner people living in New York and California are the ones feeling most fat, and the ones being most fat feel actually quite thin, living in Louisiana and Missouri. Then again, there's an artist who used infographics and data to create new forms of sharing recipes. So this is her version of white lasagna, which you should definitely check out because they actually work. It's not just a beautiful picture, they work. Here's spicy chili. Here's her thoughts on tacos. And before I show you the last project that I really love, I just want to close with the way that I see digital culture. It's not something we can walk away from or embrace without thinking about it. I think in a way we're in a similar situation that we as a human culture were in the 50s when fast food was coming out. Because now we sort of see that as something that is dirty or unhealthy. But when it came out, it was something that we all thought was great. Artificial flavorings, wow, amazing. You could get exactly the same flavor with every time you made the sandwich. It was very cheap. It was delicious. People got like really nutrition from it. It generated an industry. It was awesome. Only it took like 10 to 20 years for people to have like heart failure and obesity before we really started thinking about, wait a minute, is this really working? And I think that is one of the reasons why the slow food movement is such an amazing thing, because it started to make us think about what we're doing as a culture with the food that we consume. So what I do at ITFA, we show stuff that's made on the web with the web that is actually not fast and is not posts and tweets, but that is actually the slow web in a way. These are projects like We Feel Fine. You can spend hours in there. It's like watching a film, only a different type of medium. So I just want to close with one of my very favorite examples of that, which is a project called Bear 71. It was nominated in 2012. And if you have a moment later this week, switch off your phone, sit behind your computer, get a nice glass of wine, like switch off all notifications and just spend 20 minutes with this project. And if you like it, there's more in November.
Banff National Park in the heart of the Canadian Rockies. Bears and humans here live closer together than any other place on Earth. That explains the radio caller constantly beeping my location to some ranger playing God. They also gave me a number. Bear 71. For 11 years, I did everything right. Looking back on it now, it all seems unstoppable. There are 15 remote sensing cameras in my home range. It's hard to say where the wired world ends and the wild one begins. The rangers know where I am from the day I leave my den in the spring to the day I go back to sleep in the fall.
So thank you, and enjoy the rest of the meal.
Thank you, Cosper. Are there questions from the audience? Does anyone have, yeah, a question for Casper?
I want to ask something. I see you're worried about things about the food and so. What is your opinion about being worried about etiquette? I think also with Facebook and people eating just in front of computers, people start to eat without any interest, like sitting like this and doing with only a fork. I think that's also very apart from the communication between people is going away.
Do you have kids who eat like this?
No, because I don't let him.
Okay.
Well, I think it's. I'm not sure we were that polite before the internet. Like, if I look at how my grandfather was eating, he was eating with one fork and a newspaper, and he was not talking to my grandmother. Like, there's a lot of things that we blame the internet for that are actually just us being egotistical dicks as human beings. That said, the internet is making it a lot easier to actually misbehave.
It is a trend. Maybe it's coming also from the United States because people don't eat with fork and knife normally there. But I think it's a trend because for my work, I eat a lot also outside. I'm a person with KLM, with Dutch Airlines, so I eat a lot in restaurants also all over the world. And I see more people eating just, yeah, in a very...
One aspect of that is that, of course, thanks to the internet and smartphones, we have our work inbox with us nonstop, where the distinction between work and play and private time are completely blurring right now. And we as human beings have not really found our way to deal with that. Now we actually have to switch things off. I love how it's also a generational thing because I see people younger than me are behaving much better than I am. And I love it, for instance, I used to work in a cinema. Like when I go to the cinema with my dad, when his phone rings, like we both forget to switch off our phone. When his phone rings, he picks it up. He's like, oh, I'm sorry. No, I'm in a cinema. I switch it off. And that's something because he grew up in a culture where if you have, like, it could be anyone, it could be important, you have to pick up the phone. And there is a generation under us that is actually knowing that it's a choice to use devices or not. So I don't think it's a question of, I don't want to be too pessimistic in that sense. It's just want to say it's we're the ones doing it, right?
Who considers himself like eating as a, you know, like a beast? No one. You. Okay, well, we'll find out. You have a question.
In which food project do you personally see the most for the future?
The opposite of Soylent. there's a thing called Kitchen Surfing, which is quite a commercial website, but I thought it was pretty interesting. And a pretty interesting idea, the sharing economy. There's a lot of things that the internet are doing great. Like, I can order the most ridiculous, cool types of cider from a website right now that I could never actually discover.
Like, which one?
I cannot even remember the name
right now. Oh, okay. That's a shame. Are there more questions? Yes. Last question.
It's an attempt to rescue the reputation of Korea. I just come back and I visited a cooperative called Hansalim. It's an organic farmer and consumer cooperation, 2,000 farmers, 400,000 members, 1.6 million people in the families, 1,600 stores. And they see a major shift in the orders away from internet booking back to the shops. And I think this is a good sign.
I totally agree. I think it's actually, the countries that have the worst, that we get the worst examples from, like the US, Korea, the Netherlands, are also the countries that we have the most hopeful things, right? Like the Food Film Festival.
The Food Film Festival, yeah. Thank you so much, Casper Sonnen. Yes, and there is another great initiative, which is called the Film Food Network. And I'd love to, the Food Film Network, and I'd love to introduce Janno Lanja, one of the founders of the Food Film Festival. Please, with a warm applause, Jan Oloya, you can take a seat over there. Yeah. What can you tell us about the network?
Well, I can tell you, well, it started all with the first food film festival. Yeah. And we just, you know, a couple of friends and me, we started it, we did it. And much to my surprise, because I'm a very realistic guy, everyone came. I mean, more than everyone. It was completely sold out the first time, and we never expected it. Or at least I, to be honest, didn't expect that a big success. And also we got, from the start, a lot of volunteers from other places in Europe, mostly in Europe, even some out of Europe. And that's because we're part of the Youth Food Movement, which is the youth organization of Slow Food. So we had this web of people, but people actually traveled all the way and everyone liked it in the same fashion. So I think it's a sort of an international sentiment at the moment that you want to both combine like the film and stories about food, but also get reconnected with the origin of your food.
And what are the goals for the Food Film Network?
Well, we thought, well, you can organize a food film festival also in Paris or Berlin. But we couldn't, of course. So what we started looking for was food film festivals like us in different places. And the Food Film Network, the goal of that, because we found those festivals, is to make our work a little easier, more
it's
fun.
Always good, yeah.
And just help each other out. Because everyone, everywhere, our people are feeling the same thing, apparently.
And today we will launch the Food Film Network.
Yeah.
And we're going to do that by signing a manifest, but you're not going to do that alone. Is this
no,
the one?
This is the one we're going to sign.
So I'd like to introduce on stage Veronica Esquer, director Film & Cook Barcelona and Madrid. Yes, you can applaud, of course. Ivo Kara Pesic, coordinator of the Kinokunst Festival in Ston, Croatia. Becky Vipont, director of the Food for Real in Liverpool. Yes. And Barbara Cerulis, director's Krachtvoer in Antwerpen. Welcome, everybody. Hi.
Hi.
Good to have you. Hi. Welcome. Hi.
Hi.
Good to have you here. Hello, hello. Hello. So, can you please tell us all from which festival you're from and why you want to join this Food Film Network?
Mm-hmm. As Jano say, we start in Barcelona the same month and the same year as Food Film Amsterdam, and since the beginning we have been in contact. And we are more focused. We're a festival like, quite different from the rest because we are very focused in high gastronomy. Because Spain now has a lot of things to say in that. So we are very, very focused in this way, no? But we begin last year also in Madrid. We have, in November, we have Barcelona and also Madrid. And the expectations are quite good, just to every edition to have different things and to grow also, I think, like the rest of the festivals.
Great, and it will be in November.
Yes.
So if you want to,
you are also
join,
invited.
Okay, good. And what food film festival do you work for?
I work for Kino Okus, which means Cine Taste in Croatian, and we started in 2010. So we are probably the smallest but the oldest food film festival here, and we established it in Ston, which is a small town near Dubrovnik on Dalmatian coast. And our idea was to organize a festival in a small place where there was no cultural event, but we wanted it to stem from the peculiarities of that place. And Ston is a perfect place for a food film festival because there is a bay where they grow oysters and mussels. And it's on the peninsula, which is very famous by wines. and there is old Salina there. So what is particular about our festival is that all the screenings are in open door cinemas. Yeah. Because we have nice weather and it's in September.
So now you sold Storm. I definitely want to go there. You visited? Yeah, was it good?
And it was amazing. So, I mean, like vacation-wise, that's definitely the best festival to go to.
But it's also good, you know, to be a network and to go and travel and be abroad. Yeah. Visit each other, so we're very
happy to
have you.
And
here,
we are very proud to be part of this initiative, which is a wonderful initiative, and we are strongly believe in joining forces, so that's why we are here.
Perfect, thank you.
Hi. Yes, I'm Becky from Food for Real. Our festival is in November, it's not quite as sunny and
so now
warm.
We have to choose. Okay, so now you have to sell Liverpool.
Our festival came out of our work. We work in health and well-being and use the arts very much to educate and empower people around food. We started our festival 3 years ago. Our festival is a free festival, so we raise funds to make sure that all the activity, all the film and all the workshops are free for people to attend. So a lot of our work is about social inclusion, about education and empowerment for people who may not necessarily have access to that sort of information.
That's great. Yeah. And you will have to teach us all how to be such a good fundraiser.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's very important, I think. And the festival is in November as
it's
well.
It's in November as well,
okay,
yes.
Perfect.
I'm Barbara. I'm the organizer of Kracht voor in Antwerp, together with you, who's sitting over there. We just started last year. We had our first edition in October. You and I have a food blog. It's called Alle Dagen Honger. And
what's it called?
Alle Dagen Honger. So
Allerlei Honger.
Yeah.
Okay.
Alle Dagen Honger.
Yeah. All days hungry.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Thanks.
And actually, we just had we came to the Food Film Festival in Amsterdam. We visited Mad Food Camp in Copenhagen, the symposium by René Redzepi. And we really wanted to do something similar in Belgium. So we went to Villanella, which is an art center in Antwerp. And we asked if we could organize a food film festival there. And they said yes, so we were very happy. So our first edition, we showed a lot of documentaries, 10 of them. For us, it was a lot. Here it's not a lot. But we noticed that documentary as such is a bit difficult in Belgium, so we combine it often with a lecture or a debate afterwards. So
why do you think documentary is difficult in Belgium?
It feels like we don't have such a big tradition as here in the Netherlands. Also on national television, it always gets programmed late at night in the evening. So I don't know. It's not
so
such
I think
a popular genre.
I mean, I like. There's a question over here.
Are you only interested in Belgium documentaries? Is that what you're saying, or?
No, not at all. Okay. We're also programming international documentaries, but it's hard to build an audience for it. That's what I was. Yeah, an audience. Yeah, that was what I was trying to say. So
that is a great motivation to join a food film network,
true.
So that the audience will grow. Yeah.
I'll come to Antwerp in October.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not very far. And so we also have workshops, tastings, a big market, and exposition. And we also always work around one team, so we have a central team. So.
Jano, aren't you very proud that you are already, you know, growing this fast?
It's amazing. You can see that, I mean, the Food Film Festival has expanded very rapidly in 4 years, of which I'm very proud. We moved successfully, I would say, to the Westergast, to this location, and now we're expanding internationally in the sense that we connect ourselves to these lovely festivals. And the fun stuff is there are way more because I mean, last autumn, I and a couple of colleagues of mine we've visited all these lovely festivals and we spoke about what the goals of the network should be. And so we invited everyone here and we wanted to sign it. But yesterday, when we spoke for the final agreement on this, afterwards we had people from Italy, from Czech Republic, from South Africa, and they're all willing and starting up new food film festivals. So, you know, I can feel that we're an interesting network also for filmmakers, for distributors, but also for cities. So there's lots and lots of possibilities.
And what is the main goal?
I would say the main goal for everyone is to get more and more people interested in what their food is and where it comes from, and the way how you can represent it. Like, for example, the lovely speech that Casper did. It's, you know, there is lots and lots of images around on food, and there is a strong bond between food and images. And yeah, I think that's the main thing of the food film festivals.
I think we have an official moment now. Yes, the launch of the network. How will we do it? Everybody?
I think everyone just signs and then
okay,
that's
good.
It. Because it's not
okay.
That interesting.
Ta-da-da. Do we have some music, you know, to to make something out of it? Great, great
I'll just
signature.
Let's go
yeah.
fast.
We go fast, yeah. And I think...
I would like to raise the glass, but aren't there any more wine glasses?
Oh. Wait,
you can pour some wine maybe in the...
Laura, please. I think...
White or red?
Red.
So the white is
no,
for
no,
someone
no,
else.
No, it's okay.
This is
yours?
Do you want a glass of wine?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
And
this is the red one?
This
white one.
You
want?
Evil.
Red.
Do you want red?
I'm sorry, I didn't do it perfect.
You also.
Thank you.
Good. Good. A little bit more for you.
Well then, to the Food Film Network.
Everybody, raise your glasses to the Film Food Network official launch. Congratulations. I think this is a... Yeah, make a lot of pictures, come here. Just stand in front of them. This is the moment. Thank you so much. Please bring your wine. Yeah, don't leave them on the tables. Drink it all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let me see. I'd like to welcome on stage three filmmakers who all made films about famous chefs. One of them is called Pere Solés from Spain, Berry van Galen from Holland, and Willemiek Kluifhout. I'm so sorry, Remco couldn't come. Please come over here. Yes, and you can applaud. I know, you know, maybe it will just keep you warm. Hey, hello. Ik had jou nog niet gezien.
Hi.
Hi. Willemiek.
Remco,
take a seat. Yeah, is it okay for you like this? Yeah, maybe you can just come a little bit closer.
Closer.
Is that okay? No? Okay. Perry, you made, you're one of the directors of Inside the Best Restaurant in the World, El Cellar de Can Roca. What is your film about?
Firstly, I would like to... Before I answer your questions, I'd like to thank the festival for inviting us to this very interesting festival, to this beautiful city with this nice weather. And
I'm really, it's horrible.
We are really yeah. happy to be here.
You enjoy the weather.
Yeah, yeah, really.
Good.
It's
good.
A real
it's
Amsterdam.
Still warm in Spain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So can you tell us what your film is about?
Well, our film is not about gastronomy. It's about the history of a family. It's about the history of three brothers that had a dream, and they achieved it without renouncing to their roots. Mm-hmm. It's just like a little tale. That's what we wanted to explain in this documentary.
Good. Thank you. Willemiek, welcome.
Thank you.
You're the director of Sergio Herman's Fucking Perfect. And you're still working on this film.
Yeah.
What is the film about?
Oh, okay. So, actually, I'm doing the last shoot this month, and I've been following the cook Sergio Herman for over a year, starting last March in 2013. Of course, I have an idea where the film will be about, but mostly I know that only after editing I start to have a sense what it's
Surprise,
really
about. This is what I did.
Okay, but it's mainly about not about gastronomy alone. It's mostly about ambition and the sacrifices you make for your ambition.
And are you? I mean, normally in the process of filmmaking, you have always this moment of, oh my God, is this going to be a good film or not? Where are you at the moment?
I think it's going to be a good film.
Good for you. Good. I'm very happy that you're so confident.
No,
that's very good.
Yeah. I had some shots that I think, okay, this can make the film. Yeah.
We always must 30 otherwise.
And Berry, you're the director of L'Universel de Pourcelles. Can you tell us what your film is about?
Well, my film is it's more a kind of a recreation than a documentary, but I tried to make a documentary about it. Mm-hmm. For they asked the Purcell brothers, they asked themselves to make that film. So it's more.
Do we know the Purcell brothers?
No.
Okay, can you tell us
something.
Who the Purcell brothers are?
That's one egg, what is it? Identical twin brothers, and they have a star restaurant in Montpellier in France. And the one brother, it's Laurent, and he works in Montpellier. He has a wife, and he's kind of, he likes to stay at home and not too many things. And his brother, Jacques, he likes the adventure, he's wild, he's from the man, and he's a totally different man as his brother. And he is going all over the world to explore and make new business. And that's the reason why they asked me to make a film about the work of Jacques in France.
Yeah, and they're like very famous chefs.
They are very, very famous, yeah.
Good. What I'd like to do with you is show some different clips, and then we just find out. And if you have questions, we just go into the clips and what we see. And I'd like to start with a clip about Sergio.
En Simon had naar tafel 18 met Wieland.
Yes.
Let op, je hebt een uitzondering. Geen pork en de zwangere.
We staan voor positie 1, hè?
Straks tafel 6. Tafel 6 is VIP, hè?
Ja.
Zeer moeilijke man, hè? Goed in de gaten houden, goed zwanjeren, ja?
Ja?
Van begin tot einde, zeer kritisch.
Ja.
We work the last ones and then we go on 6 bulgur and 4 grab.
Ja, kan niet zeggen.
Dat is goed. Next. Yes.
Ik heb een mooi blancheren.
Ja.
Die nerven.
Ja, dat is geen probleem. Er zit ook rode man.
Hey guys, hey cooks. Hey, we go for a fucking good week this weekend, guys.
Ja.
Gezellig.
Ja, very cozy. What was it like filming in his restaurant?
As you can see, the
maybe you can grab the mic a bit more closer or not. Yeah.
Yeah. How can I get it off? Can I talk like this? Like that. Okay. So what happened last year is that he shut down his 3-star restaurant in December. So when I started following him in March, I knew that he was gonna close down his restaurant, but almost nobody else knew by the time. And he really wanted to do like something else in his life, and it was becoming like a kind
of... And he told you?
And his wife.
And are you? No, my God! But are you like close friends? Or?
No. But I made a documentary. He was part of a documentary before.
Yeah.
And he was kind of hinting on it.
Yeah.
And
so he wanted you to make a documentary.
Sometimes I have the feeling. I for a long time I thought I had chosen him, but maybe it's also. Maybe
he chose
it works
you.
Like that
yeah.
a little bit. But anyways, so that was called that's called Oudsluis. And. The place is really, really small, and it started off same as your as a family restaurant, mm-hmm. But it became bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, and then this 3-star restaurant. And it's really, really small. So we were there with the camera, and it was extremely difficult with all these boys running around really fast and being in between. Yeah.
But it's also very stressful. Did he ever like push you away, or, I mean, you know what I mean? You look. be honest. Try.
Actually, in this restaurant, they were so used to the small space and like touching each other all the time and going around each other that we weren't that kind. They made a way around us. It was okay. But now, for example, he's in a bigger restaurant and now they feel they have the space. And in a way, it's more difficult now to move around with the camera. So it's a bit strange, yeah.
And how important is filming the food in a film about a chef?
I think it's really important. I mean, I make this film about it because he's such a good chef and he does something extremely well with his food. So, I mean, it's like when you make a film about a singer, it should be, it's really strange not to have him
so
sing.
No.
So I want to show him.
But it's the story you want to tell. If you want to tell how they work or how they organize or something, then it's about how they organize, or it's about the food, it's about the food. So, yeah, that's not always the same, I think.
Are there questions from the audience? It is pretty obvious, though, but yeah, great.
I wanted to ask you, because we screened a lot of films on our festival about chefs, and I was shocked when I saw the first film, how stressful it is to work in the kitchen, and there is this military approach. So don't you think that there is a little bit of contradictory between, you know, feeling pleasure in eating something good and then realizing what is all behind? Because
extremely, yeah. Actually,
I was thinking about energy, you know, who is cooking for you, so it has to be nice. He's happy to prepare it for you. Then you realize that they almost hate to what they do.
Okay, this is going to be a big element in the film. This extreme contrast between all this fucking and swearing and being really rough and all this pressure, and then this delicate 3-star food and this fine refinement and the creativity and the time they spend on it. So there's this large contrast, and in the film I use it so you see how stressful it's being made, but I also have these moments of him alone and going really into the food and then having it almost like a painting and very slowly and meditative. And so I work with that, and yeah, and that contrast is a big part of the film. Yeah.
Do you still like going to restaurants?
Well, yeah, I do. I prefer to go to friends to eat at their houses. sincerely speaking, but to me,
because of this reason.
Not only because of this reason, but Noma, for example, film about Noma was shocking for me. How he treats his colleagues and things like that. So, I think Michelin stars very nice, but if that is the atmosphere in the kitchen, maybe not.
Well, that is what Willemieke is showing
but
us.
And it's also the big contrast. So when you sit there in the restaurant, you have your, like, in this wonder world, and everybody treats you nice. You don't have a clue what's happening behind you there. Yeah. And the 18 hours a day they make. And
18 hours a day?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
I must stress it, not always like that in all 3-star kitchens. I've been to a lot of 3-star kitchens, and some of them are really quite relaxed. So it also depends a lot on the personality of the chef.
Yeah, in a push-up.
And I know Sergio Hamrin is quite an explosive chef, so that's how his kitchen looks like. But for instance, if you go to Zwolle Libreye, it's a relaxed atmosphere. The kitchen is open, people go in and out, there's no swearing. So it depends also a lot on the personality.
Thank you for sharing this. So now we can, you know, enjoy yourselves at the Libreye. And feel, yeah, thank you.
And that's still open, eh?
Thank you.
But and how is it in, I'm very curious how it is in your restaurant.
No, I agree with him, because I think that, like in all other jobs, it depends on the character of the people who works there. And that is not true that in every restaurant there is bad manners. There is a stress, of course, because if you are one of the best of the world, you has to keep to maintain
keep up the level.
Yeah, that's it. And there is a stress, of course, when you try something new. For example, in our documentary, we show that moment of stress, but it's a stress. It's not bad manners. It's a great difference, I think. It's, these people, well, in our case, are people who are well fanatics of their job, and they love it. And
let's watch a scene of El Cellar de Can Roca.
Okay.
Yes.
I ara es tractaria de bastir això amb un joc d'elements que funcionin i que generin contrast o afinitat. I ara estem en ple procés de veure si això funciona, si això té sentit, si té gràcia o no. Vale, sí que tenemos que hacer esto, de pegarla en vacío para que quede más prensada, porque ves, al cortar se separa y esto no tiene...
Hay que quedar más...
Sí. Ahí está. Pega más.
El vacío, ¿no?
Pero con papel, ¿eh?
Sí.
Es un plat de carn de puta mare, ¿no?
¿Eh?
Es un plat de carn de puta mare.
Es un plat de peix, collons. En tot cas, és un mar i muntanya, que ja ens toca. Jo jugaria més amb el bro de les sardines, ¿eh?
Vamos a cambiar la proporción. Vamos a poner más fondo de sardina a la brasa y menos... espuma de carne y lo volvemos a probar.
Picante.
Wow, I love all this talking about food. it seems less hectic.
What?
It seems less hectic.
Hectic, what do you mean? Hectic?
Like less panic?
Less panic, yeah.
Yeah, they were just
well,
like...
Yes, here is the Roca Lab, where they try new things. And as you can see, these people, well, it's his way of well, it's their character.
Yeah.
They are really nice, and well, they. I think you can see it in their kitchen.
Yeah. But when they have to prepare it in a kitchen, it's military work.
Yeah, but
in the beginning, it's very soft and delicate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But as I told you. Is in a controlled stress in the kitchen.
Was it difficult for the Roca brothers to accept you in their world?
Well, not really, because these people in this restaurant works 65 people, and they serve to 50 people every night.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. And in the kitchen, there are, I think, 35 cookers. So it's quite a lot of people, but they are really friendly. And well, we went there with a very small team to avoid disturbing their job.
And how was that for you? The Purcell brothers, did they accept you easy in their habitat?
Well, they had to. This one? This one? Yeah, this? Okay, this one. Well, I met Jacques when I went to Shanghai, only the day before I started filming.
Yeah.
So, we had to do it. We had Alain Caron, I know who he is.
Do we know? Maybe you should just tell us.
Okay, he's a friend of Jacques.
Yeah.
And Alain invited me to make the film. So I went with Alain Caron to Shanghai. And there, they were friends, I met Jacques. And then the next day I started working there on the expo. And I had a week, but...
So you have like this big restaurant, this French restaurant in Shanghai at the expo.
It is not, no, it is not. Yeah. It, they had the French pavilion in on the expo in over there. And Jacques Purcell was invited by France to make there to cook there in the restaurant. But this was a really small restaurant. And it was so small, I couldn't stand... I had a as you so
you couldn't little stand
place.
It.
I could, yeah, I could, there was no place for me, but I had to. So it was, yeah, I was there every day, and I worked there 5 days in the kitchen.
Let's watch a scene, a little clip.
Yeah, with the Chinese.
Les Chinois adorent le pain français, donc le pain, ils considèrent un peu que c'est comme un gâteau. Donc ils le mangent à la fourchette, ils le découpent avec le couteau. Et surtout le pain, ils veulent le garder jusqu'au dessert. Ils ne veulent pas qu'on leur enlève le pain au moment du dessert. Donc le pain, pour eux, c'est le complément presque du dessert. Et faire les miettes et enlever le pain, c'est quelque chose de très compliqué pour leur expliquer que ça se fait comme ça en France. Donc il y a de nombreuses fois où on laisse le pain sur table pour le dessert.
We mainly see the guests. Is that because you wanted to show us the restaurant?
Sorry?
We see a lot of guests, you know, eating the food.
Yeah.
Is that because you wanted to show the restaurant?
Yeah, for the I made a film for the Pucelle, so they could show the Chinese people what they are doing. What they could do, that they were there on the expo, and they make a big job over there. So that they asked me to make a film where you see how what they do, how much work they do over there. That it's great, all the Chinese, and to introduce France to the Chinese people. Yeah.
Good. There's another scene of your film.
Je crois que ça s'est fait naturellement. On aimait faire la cuisine, on avait la chance d'habiter dans un petit village où il y avait un restaurant qui était étoilé Michelin. Et on allait le week-end travailler et s'exercer un petit peu à la cuisine. C'est comme ça que les choses se sont faites. Pour nous, c'était naturel. On nous a pas imposé ce métier, on se l'est pas imposé à nous-mêmes.
Et bon, mais c'est vrai que les jumeaux, on est tellement proches. Je veux dire, bon, avec Jacques, d'un regard, on se comprend. Voilà, on partage beaucoup de choses et c'est vrai que cette année, le fait qu'ils ne soient pas là pendant 6 mois, pour moi c'est quand même dur parce que on a tellement l'habitude de prendre les décisions ensemble, de régler les problèmes ensemble, de communiquer ensemble, d'avancer ensemble. Cette année, c'est quand même dur, quoi, de ne pas l'avoir avec moi, quoi.
I like that because it's their work, it's about their work, but the emotion is in that they are brothers and they miss each other, and therefore I try to tell something about their relationship in the film. Yeah.
So, but is it like difficult to, because it's a document, it's a corporate documentary.
Yeah. Yeah.
to have like a proper combination between food, between the food making, the preparing, and the personal lives.
Yeah, I don't know if the Chinese can they can understand something about that. Yeah. But yeah, I for myself I don't like films without emotion, so I try to put it in. So yeah.
Are there questions?
Hello, my name is Rick. I was interested in how big your teams were when you make the films. You mentioned it was like you were in a small place in the kitchen. Yeah. With how many people were you, and how were you like cooking your film?
In our case, our team was really small. We needed to be a small team because otherwise we couldn't be there. In a kitchen with 35 people working, you can imagine how difficult it could be to be with a team of 10 or 15, is impossible.
Yeah.
So we were only four people, the cameraman, the sound man,
yeah,
and the two directors, the two co-directors, that was all. And the producer was out of the kitchen, waiting us outside.
Thank you for producing,
yeah.
Now you have to move. Okay, and you're directing the film with your colleague? Yes, he's here as well.
David, who's there?
David, hi. Thank you for all the good work. maybe it's good to watch a scene of the Rocker Brothers as well.
Okay.
Bueno, això és casa, no? Estem a casa. Aquí és on hem... estat sempre. I seguim estant cada dia quan tornem. Quan venim, si més no, quan venim a dinar. Això és una truita de carbassó.
Ai, per favor.
Una truita de carbassó.
No la podeu fer més petita.
Però és líquida. No l'heu de posar sencera a la boca.
Això
era una collonada.
De collonades en feu moltes, eh? Clar, això, eh?
Això és una... Això és una galeta de gambes.
Un telegamba.
Ah, un telegamba. La gamba ve després.
Però com ens enganya, no tens la gamba.
Sí, sí. Són petites.
Us ho passeu bé, eh?
So what did we see here?
Well, those are their parents, yeah. And that was the first time they ate this menu, the El Celler de Can Roca menu. And well, we told them, we asked them to show us that first time, and they agreed. And,
well, yeah, but the parents, I mean, they're all from like a cooking family.
Yeah.
And their sons are like the big chefs.
Yes.
And they are like the yeah, nice...
They live in the same neighborhood where they were born and where they grew up. They didn't renounce to their roots. They decided to make a restaurant there. Yeah. And, well, from the tradition, but without closing their eyes to the new ideas, the new technologies, the new flavors and everything that arrived from around the world, they included all these new things to the tradition, and that's why they are unique. They always say that it's impossible to have another Celler de Can Roca in London or in New York or in another place, because there is the place where they belong.
But it seems like it's more, it's the three brothers, of course.
Yeah.
But it's also the rest of the family.
Yeah, of course, the rest of the family was the origin of everything. Yeah. And from there, they start their career. Yeah,
love to go there.
Yeah,
to go
you
there.
Must, you yeah. must. But it's 1 year of waiting, so...
1 year of
you
waiting.
You should call now for next year.
But you know them pretty good.
Oh, really?
Yeah? So we have to... yeah. So we're like doing the reviews.
Hello. I do have two questions, actually, for all of you. Do you have any anecdote to tell us? Because in the kitchen, quite a lot of interesting things happen, something that was really funny maybe, or that you could share that with us. And also, chefs, have they seen the movies? And have they say, okay, I don't want this part to be there. So any cuts done for them, especially?
So you want to know what they don't want us to know.
Exactly, independence of your work.
You're a journalist.
Well, it's a secret.
In our case, there is one scene that when Joan, the chef, realized that we were there, he said, "Oh, I don't like you to put this scene in the film, because well, it's a scene. It's about what we were talking about. Is that it's an scene where Joan." Has a lot of stress because they are trying to put in the menu a new dish, and he shouts, "Oh, doesn't work. It can, it's horrible. And all the brothers and Juan himself told me that was the first time in all year that that happened in that kitchen, and we were there. So you were happy.
Yes, I was. Some emotions.
And I asked him to let me put in the film that scene, to show people how the stress of a kitchen is when they are serving a new dish, and he agreed.
A small anecdote.
Yeah. I'm not sure yet, but my film is still in production, so there's not now.
Actually, if I may, we'd like to show the last scene of a scene from your film, from Sergio. It's a very personal scene in a car.
I know.
Alleen maar gewerkt, keihard gewerkt, alleen maar 18, 19, 20 uur per dag gewerkt. Zonder dat ik, nee, heb ik alleen maar gewerkt eigenlijk. En dat was het. Dat was mijn focus. En dan ben je ook niet de gezelligste. Dan ben je ook niet de vader die je moet zijn misschien. Of de vriend of de man, weet je wel.
Mooi. For the people who don't speak Dutch, he's telling us that he's like working really, really hard. 18, 19, 20 hours a day, night. And that he's like doubting if he's like a good dad or having a good social life.
Or a good husband. Yeah. Okay, but I have a small anecdote because I spend a lot of times every time after. So I came every month to film him, and then in the night we had like these evening car trips, and it was kind of meditation time that he said like, okay, this is where I stand now and everything. But every time he stopped at like how you say this gas stations. And he bought really bad, like licorice and Red Bull and all these things that a three-star Michelin guy shouldn't eat or do.
Funny, why do you think he did that? To keep up the balance.
Because it's late and you work 20 hours a day.
You need it, sugar.
I'm sorry? Yes, definitely.
Yeah, I understand.
Good. And do you think
the contrast,
and do you think he will like that?
He will
be okay.
For now, he has been okay, but there's not a film yet, so
okay, good.
But we'll see what
kind of
argument. What's
your relationship with him? What's your relationship with Herman? Are you,
Well, he spends more time with him probably than his wife.
No, it's not that bad.
Well, if I hear this,
it's not that bad. But he's very open.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, it's great that he's like that. Yeah. To end this little meeting, a small anecdote from the Purcell brothers.
Yeah. First, I want to answer his question with how many people you work.
Thank you.
I worked in my own, so it's a small kitchen, and I'm the interviewer and the camera woman and everything.
And you're a very talented person.
No.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks. And
yes,
I have not anecdote in the kitchen for it's. I was the in Shanghai. It was so big. You have the kitchen, and then 100 kilometers further, you have the other things, and so I was only in the kitchen, and there, nothing horrible happened, so I cannot tell anything about it. But my problem was there that I was in Shanghai, and there my camera stopped, and I needed a Sony cleansing tape for the camera, and it
so
was
you
not
had your
in Shanghai.
Own drama.
Yeah, there were dramas enough. Yeah. And afterwards, but not in the kitchen. It was all very organized, and there, no screaming, nothing. No, nothing.
Great. No. You're a lucky person.
Yeah.
No. Please give them a. Do you? Oh, you want? Sorry.
Three.
Three.
We were three. Sorry.
Because we're running out of time a little bit, I would love to give you a very, very warm applause. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Perrin, Willemiek, and Barry, thank you so much. Please take a seat, and then I'd love to welcome on stage John Appel. Well, let's sit there. Why not? Why not? It's a very well-known Dutch documentary filmmaker. We probably all have seen your film about André Hazes. He is the man, he did that. And not only that, you can applaud for that one. Because that's like a great movie. But you also did like, The Player, Wrong Time, Wrong Place, and well, and today we're going to talk about The Lost Victory. Yes, and we're going to talk about a little clip you selected. So maybe it's a good idea to just start with the clip and then talk about it. Yeah?
Quando si parla di palio nella nostra contrada, nei nostri cuori e nei nostri volti non calasse un velo di tristezza. Vorrei tanto che i bambini che sono il nostro futuro e la nostra forza non piangessero più. Vorrei rendervi felici. Perché voi siete la grinta, voi siete il cuore, ma soprattutto siete la passione. E domani chi mi conosce bene lo sa, faremo di tutto per essere protagonisti, per riportare la civetta nel gradino più alto, alla vittoria. La dea bendata o la fortuna, come si vuol chiamare, ci ha assegnato il cavallo Berio. In tempi non sospetti avevamo avuto il desiderio di averlo nella stalla. Lui ci ha ascoltato.
This is such a great scene. Yes, you can applaud for this one. Because this was a lot of work. What do we see here? Is the mic working?
It's not really working.
Yeah, it does.
Okay,
yeah.
It's working right now. Okay, it's a film. This film is about the palio, which is in Italy, Siena, a yearly event in which the different districts of the city compete in a horse race, which takes only 75 seconds. And this is the night before. And I was filming one of the districts that hadn't been winning for about 25 years. So they needed a victory. They really needed a victory. And now, really by lottery, it's also about superstition, they had the best horse. So they're, you know, thinking, hoping, wishing they are going to win the next day. And so what they are doing now is they are celebrating the last, I would say it feels a little bit like the Last Supper, you know. The next day, somebody's going to be crucified. And you see the people in the, you know, in the long table, and they're the main protagonists of the film, who, and it's the let's say the most important person of the captain of the district, who is really hopes to give victory to his people, and behind, next to him, it's the jockey, the man on the horse. And he's the, if you know the story of the film, he's the Judas. He's the one who can betray the whole game, which is about horse racing and about making deals with other districts. So even the best horse and even the best jockey, they're not a guarantee for a victory. So there's a lot of tension in this scene, since everybody hopes to win, but only the jockey, he can tell, because he knows already.
And have you seen the film? Yes? Yeah, because I'm like, from did he win, or didn't, or don't you want to tell?
No, I can tell, because yeah, nobody has seen the film. Yeah. Okay. If
yeah, then you know, I mean.
They can check it, eh?
Yeah.
No, they didn't win. And that's,
I didn't want to tell, you know, because otherwise, well, yeah, then they're not going to watch my film.
Well, you can still watch your film. Still watch it. No, they didn't win, and of course, yes, they realized that the jockey, he made a deal with somebody else, and he got more money for losing than he would have got for winning, so he chose to lose.
Oh.
This is Italy, yeah? It could never happen in the Netherlands, you know.
No,
never.
We're all so honest, and our eating is so perfect, isn't
yes
it? Yeah. Do you consider there in documentaries there is a lot of important food scenes? I mean, in fiction films we know, but in documentaries maybe it's not so.
No, not so many. Since, to my big surprise, you know, you see a lot of characters in documentaries and they don't have to sleep, they don't eat, and they don't have sex. So they do what they do. So they you know, they're singing or they're cooking, you know. You agree with me?
They do go to gas stations, but that's about it.
Yes. So, yeah. You know, eating in a documentary seems to be so banal that you don't show it. And I think it's, of course, there are eating scenes, supper scenes, but I really don't recollect one of them.
No.
To be honest, yes.
No. And you did a perfect job. It's almost like very filmic. How would you say that? Filmic? That's a great. Is it a word? A cinematic.
Yes.
Thank you. Yeah.
Well, it was meant for cinema. Eh, this
yeah
film.
But so. How many cameras did you use?
Only one camera.
Really?
Yes, really.
And
yes,
you didn't ask them to okay one more time.
No, but it's all repetitive. You know, it's like all those people singing for hours. I didn't have to ask them to do it one more time. Yes.
Good.
No.
Good.
It's just being on the right time at the right spot. That's.
And why do you think in documentary we don't see people eating that much or the food?
I told you it's so banal. And
do you think so? Is it?
No, I don't think it's banal. Yeah. But in documentary, it seems to be so banal that they don't suppose everybody when he's doing something he already had dinner. You know.
Yeah.
And maybe since you, I think the only documentary that really show scenes about food, they are here at the Food Film Festival.
Yeah.
They are about food. And if the film is not about food, there's no need to show people eating.
Yeah.
Somehow it might distract you from the story of the film.
But in your film, it's like an artistic value.
But it's part of culture.
Yeah.
You know, this is Italy, yeah. And have eating with the community of people, since, you know, the long tables in the streets, they're typically Italian, or maybe in Croatia, or maybe in Spain, you know, but for sure in the Netherlands we don't have it. It's part of the culture to bind, unite all the people.
Yeah. And, yes.
Sorry, nobody can hear you. One moment.
I just can suggest that from this year or last year, there's the 5th of May, we have liberation festivals with food in the streets. And all the people from the neighborhoods are eating together. And it's very, it's a very nice experience. So enjoy it next year, I would say.
So in Holland, we eat as well on the street. That's what you meant to say. Yeah, we're starting doing it. Yeah.
Start doing it, and yeah. Now somebody has to film it. Yes? We will see it next year.
This probably was a request. This
how did you choose what Contrada to film? And that's the first question. And then the second one is, are the other Contradas were jealous because they are not part of the film? Because I know that in Siena it's unbelievable. They are fighting before the palio in the bars. If somebody says that this Contrada is better than the others, then it's like total disaster.
Yeah, well, I choose a Contrada that didn't win for so many years that they had to win. And since they didn't win for 25 years, and they remembered that the last time they won at that time, somebody was making a Super 8 film about them, and they won. So now I came with my 60mm film, and they expected me to bring them victory. So they let me in, but yes, and for the rest, to make a film about Siena, about the palio, they don't let anybody in to do it, since it's, for them, it's not just, you know, an event, it's bigger than life.
So how did you do that?
Well, since we worked on it for many years to get permission, and I think we were lucky to have this small Contrada really believing that we would bring them help. And about the jealousy, yes, of course. Of course, they were jealous. And but anyway, you know, like I told you, it's more than a competition. It's about big money and who's you know, making the best deals. They can be jealous, but they know they have the money to make their victory.
One last question, because I got this sign over there that there were 0 minutes left, but you were here last year, so one question for you.
Okay. I find it very interesting to know why they do not like to be filmed. That's very, very curious, especially in this time.
Yes, especially in this time, and it has to do with superstition. Partly it has to do with superstition, believing that the film camera might ruin, you know, what's at stake for them. And another reason, especially in Italy, in this palio, the fact that, you know, it's not a fair game. And if you really would show how it's really happening behind the scenes, they wouldn't love you and me. Anybody else to show it. So it's, it's something, it's a hidden, it's a secret, and they don't want to reveal it. Of course, I couldn't reveal it as well. I could only show the tension and give a glimpse of this sort of betrayal that's part of the game. And that's why they're very, you know, very reluctant to let film people in.
But you did, and we were very happy you did it. Please give him a warm and big applause, John Appel, later on. Yeah? Thank you so much. Good. And John was also one of the jury members of the feature-length competition, together with Willemieke Kluifhout, who we already saw, and Gamila Ilstra. Yeah, you may applaud. Go on. And Meg van Dinter. And I'd like to ask Meg van Dinter on stage, a food journalist from the Volkskrant. And Mick, where did you focus on while judging a food film?
Where did you focus on?
Yeah, where did you focus on?
I think we focused on seeing a good movie.
Yeah.
I think we hoped on focusing on seeing good food. I think we also hoped on seeing a message about food. And I think that the winner we had in the end had all of those.
Good.
Yep.
Good. You have is this your jury report?
Yeah, I had to make a little jury report because we had a lot of deliberations.
Okay, good. What did you think of the level of this year's selected films?
Oof, it's hard to tell because I don't know. Well, I know some of the movies from last year, but I think I had to see like 16 or 18 movies.
Yeah.
So I saw them all. I think from the other years I only saw a few. I think some of them were quite good. I also think some of them were not as good, but okay.
That's what it is.
Yeah. So I can't tell anything about the overall level of the movies compared to last year.
Okay, good. Please come a bit closer here. Already want to start reading your jury report.
Yeah.
But what we first want to tell is like the Food Film Award. It's like the first Food Film Award, and we have like a pretty nice award, a very nice award. Maybe you can you already show them? No. No, that would be weird. But Emma Levy, yeah. Emma Levy designed it, and she's a young artist, a very talented artist, and also an actress. And the idea is that every year a young upcoming artist will design a new award. So Emma Levy, I don't know if you're here. It's Samuel Levy's sister.
That's your big moment.
Talented family. Well, applaud for her anyway. It's a great, 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 great design. So, Meg, I would love to ask you to do what you plan to do, like read the jury report and tell us who's the winner of the feature-length competition.
I will. The jury is already introduced. We were four of us. There were three people with a strong cinematographic background. There was one that didn't have that background, that's me. I'm a food writer. I'm not an expert on film or movies. That was good because we could look at the films in from different perspectives, and that, in the end, that made some interesting discussions. We had to watch about, I think, 17 films that were in the competition. It's a long and time-consuming task for us all, I think. I've never experienced watching 30 to 40 hours of movie in a few weeks.
And how was that?
Well, it was work sometimes, yeah. And also, they were very different films. So we had documentaries with a strong, more activist background, with a strong political message. And we had, on the other hand, some professionally made cinema movies, which was quite a different view on things. And we had quite a discussion about what we thought should be more important. So the message or the movie, to say it in short. And in the end, we decided that the quality of the movie as such is the most important thing for a Food Film Festival Award winner. And when we reached that point, it was quite easy to declare the winner, because in the end, we were unanimous, I think. And before I wanted to say who the winner is, I would like to mention the four films that made the most impact on the jury. And they were, one of them was Salmon Confidential, which was quite a disturbing documentary about how fishing farms spread diseases that kills wild salmon in British Columbia, and how the government actively works against activists that try to do something about it. The other movie that moved us was the Bollywood film, The Lunchbox. It's about two lost souls, I would say, that communicate through food in a lunchbox. Very, well, very moving film. We thought the funniest film was the Taiwanese film called The Movable Feast. It's quite hilarious, and it depicts really the pleasure and fun that food can spread around people. So the film that brought, I think, the most laughter among us. And the other one we enjoyed a lot is My Name is Salt. It's a very poetic and mysterious film, the most poetic of all of us, of all of them, showing Indian families that extract salt from salt marshes in the north of India. As I said, in the end, we could clearly agree to a winner. And I'm not going to beat around the bush for a long time because the winner was My Name is Salt.
Maybe we... we do have a Skype connection.
Okay, yep.
But we first watch a little clip of My Name is Salt. Choice, yeah. I hope we do have an internet connection. Hello.
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 Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yes,
thank
you're so the winner of the Food Film Award.
Thank you.
Meg, do you want to say anything to Farida?
I would like Farida to congratulate her, of course, on winning this prize, because we think, we thought the jury that My Name is Salt is an outstanding movie with strong images about the labor it takes to extract something from the earth that is essential to food, and also the most common thing in food is salt. So we thought it was beautifully made, intriguing images from a world that is unknown to us, very poetic, very mysterious, and also I think very respectful to the people who did gather the salt. So we couldn't have dreamt, I think, of a better winner for the first Food Film Festival Award. So congratulations to that.
Farida, are you still there or are you just...
No, I'm there. Yeah. I couldn't hear too well, but thank you. Thanks.
And tell us, where are you now?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you too well, Meg.
I asked you where you are now.
No, sorry, I can't hear you. The connection's not too good.
We can hear her.
What time is it?
What time is it? It's 6:20 in the evening.
Oh, okay, well, that will do.
Yeah, I'm in Warsaw.
In Warsaw, okay.
Yeah.
There's also salt fields over there.
Oh,
are you in salt mines?
No, I'm attending a film festival here.
Okay, next year you'll come to ours.
Absolutely.
Okay, good.
I love Amsterdam. I'm always ready to come to Amsterdam.
Great, good. You have to. When you listen carefully, you hear a big audience applaud for you.
That's good.
And thank you for making this great and important film, Farida, and enjoy Warsaw.
Thanks. Thanks a lot.
You, bye.
Bye.
This is weird, but good. Thank you, Meg. Don't forget your iPad. Then we have another award, the shorts. And in the jury were Yvette van Boven, journalist, Catharina van Kampen, documentary and radio maker, and Jordi Wijnalda, a young filmmaker. And I'd love to introduce Jordi on stage. Hi, Jordi. So what did you focus on while judging the short? Hi. Where did you focus on while judging the short films?
Well, what was very intriguing to our jury was that there was such a wild variety in the shorts that we watched. It was really, as we say in Dutch, comparing apples and pears, which is an appropriate, you know, saying for this festival. But what we tried to focus on was originality in both content and form, and we were trying to see what film succeeded best at what it set out to do. Okay. That was pretty much our main focus. And on behalf of the other two jury members who are not here right now, I think, but who are lovely, lovely people, I want to thank the Food Film Festival for inviting us to be here, because it's, you know, it's a film festival with such a great heart and such a great message and such an optimism. And I was reminded of something that the great editor Walter Murch, who did Apocalypse Now and The Godfather and all these great things, he once said that the three professions that are mostly linked are filmmakers, chefs, and musicians, because it's all a combination of precision and intuition and passion. So I think this combination at a festival makes perfect sense. Next year, music. Just yeah,
good, good. Well, I can't sing, so. So could you please tell us who's the winner of the best short food film?
Yes, absolutely. On behalf of the whole jury, I have to talk about something real briefly that struck us as we were watching the movies. Because besides the variety of things we watched, we had a lot of animations, documentaries, a crossover documentary fiction film, and some fiction. What we noticed was the risk of having a topic that's very, very important and very, you know, something that you feel that needs to be said, overwhelming the film. We think that a good film should have form and content in a perfect marriage. We think that form and content should enhance each other. Because there's always the risk of becoming too preachy and therefore, you know, missing out on your goal because people can't access your film anymore. And the films that were the best examples in our opinion of this perfect marriage of form and content are the three that I'm going to talk about right now. These were all films that succeeded best at what they said and how they said it. Films that made us feel, films that made us think, films that made us laugh, and films that moved us. And I'm very happy to be talking about these films because all three of them were very exciting. We almost unanimously agreed on these three. So in no particular order, there is the short animation Sausage by Kirsten Lepore, which was a film about a local marketplace. Yes, please, let's applaud, let's applaud. What's being waved at me? Robert Greaves, that's cool. Sorry, Robert, a film by you. A short film about an animated film about a small town marketplace where two local market salespeople try to fight the evil arrival of capitalism in a lot of ways and consumerism. A very funny and very topical short, a film that used very classical and a beautiful, like classical traditional style to tell something that's actually very modern, so it became this kind of modern fairy tale. So congratulations on that, great film. Second one that's in our short list is Impromptu by Bruce Alcock, a Canadian short film. Let's applaud for that. Also an animated film that used a totally different style to tell a story about interhuman relationships and how food can bring people together, except for when you let the croutons burn. It's important. That's something I learned because I never knew how to make croutons. So it's the simplest thing out there, but I never knew how to do it. So I'm already grateful for that. And the third one is a Belgian short film called Kassa 9, Cash Desk 9, by Anna Heuning. Well for that. And this is actually also an animation film, and this was one done in clay, in claymation, about a slightly sad and wonderful cash desk employee who struggles with the monotony of her life, but it's a very subtle and nuanced film. And well, in our eyes, had the best actress performance because we love this clay figure, Olga, and her big bosom and her smile and her little voice. It was a very endearing short. All three of these films had unique visions, had such big hearts, had such interesting things to say and said it so well. Were so loving and so caring without ever being naive, had a very strong consciousness. And without further ado, I'd like to give the first Food Film Festival Short Film Award to Bruce Alcock with Impromptu.
Ah, great. And let's watch a little clip.
What's to drink?
Jeff's getting some wine.
Uh-huh. Why don't you use a garlic press?
Well, a garlic press makes the garlic hot and acrid.
I use one.
I'm sure you do.
Oh, shit! Oh, did any blood get on the food?
Hester, look, watch the croutons for me. Keep shaking the pan or they'll burn.
Are you there?
I am. Hello.
Congratulations. The
thank
best
you.
Short
this
food
very
film.
Nice.
What is your reaction on that, Bruce?
Well, I have to say it's particularly nice to have people who love food love the film because it's what the film is about. It's making food and making food for people you love and enjoying it together. And yeah, so it makes me very happy.
Do you want to say, as a jury, to Bruce?
Right, Bruce, congratulations. All three of us really, really enjoyed the film, and it was the first thing we talked about. And
I can't hear you, sorry. Is there a closer mic? Or?
Hey, Bruce, can you hear me now?
Yes, thanks.
It's like I'm talking to my conscience. It's very strange. Bruce, congratulations. All three jury members were very, very excited about your film. It was the first thing we talked about today, and we raved about. And we think it's such a wonderful short that is so hopeful without being naive and has such a unique style and such a great view on life and human relationships. And we all know a Hester and we've all let the croutons burn and we're all in love with Sylvie now, even though she's a handful. Is there anything you'd like to say? What are you working on right now? I'm very curious.
Let's see. I just finished a film about a disaster in Newfoundland on the ice in 1915. It was all archival photographs and shadow puppets. Nothing about food, I'm afraid.
Because we do expect you here next time. You understand that, right?
You know what? I've been looking through the recipes and all of the pictures, and I'm dying to come.
Congratulations, Bruce.
Thank you very much.
Can we hear any big applause for you, Bruce?
That's very nice.
Because we're all very happy with what you did. And thank you. A big applause for you as well. Jordi. This was it for today. The Food Film Talks. We're very happy that you were all here, that you conquered the rain and sat here. I think it was a little bit longer than we were expected. If we ever need compliments, we go to Jordi. Where do we find you, Jordi?
On the internet.
Everywhere on the internet. Yeah, very good. Thank you so much, Food Film Festival, for what you're doing. And keep up the good work. And you all have a very good trip back home. Bye-bye.